The house where Margarete Steiff lived still stands at the center of Gingen. In the turret at the corner of its second story, there's a bay window. Its three panes provide a panoramic view of the settings in which she created her life. The village streets, the river Brenz, and the factory she founded. As a child, she longed to be in the middle of activity rather than a spectator. "Please carry me to the street, even if I freeze to death," she would tell her family. Margarete's contemporary, psychologist Carl Jung, once observed that outlook determines character. It's clear that throughout Margarete's life, her outlook reflected her joyful temperament, expansive personality, sense of humor, and daring do. It was this charismatic nature that drew people to her from her earliest years. 96-year-old Mariana Steiff-Meisel recalls Margarete's magnetic personality.
She was extremely sociable, loved and understood people. Even in childhood, she knew how to hold the others near her by telling complicated stories of her own imagination, or directing their games, some of which she invented on the spot. She confesses, "I tried to make myself the center of the games," which is significant, for she certainly became the center of the games later. And she tells, if sometimes all the bigger children ran somewhere else, "I would ask the neighbors to let me have two or three of the babies in my cart." I enjoyed this tremendously.
Margarete did not see limitations. She saw potential in others. Had she not possessed this rare quality, then Steiff, the company, would not exist as we know it today. It still thrives more than six generations later as the world's premier manufacturer of toys.
When one studies her autobiography, it becomes clear that her love and affection for people was one of her great supports. She knows everybody and cares about everybody, and they care about her. She does not seem to realize that she must have been an unusually attractive companion.
Margarete was born into an era that expected a disabled female to live out her life in an asylum or a poorhouse. Under ordinary circumstances, she would have spent her days begging on the streets. She would have died impoverished. She had good health all her life, but anyone with a physical defect was considered diseased and was ostracized. Desperate for a cure, her parents took their beloved daughter to every doctor and therapy available in southern Germany. Few trains were available for traveling, so they would rise at 5 a.m. to hitch a ride on the postal wagon. Margarete often would not arrive at the doctor's office until 2 p.m. In her diary, she never expressed bitterness or frustration. Instead, she remembered with delight meeting new people, enjoying meals along the road, and living with one doctor's family, where she was free to play like a normal child. Her faith influenced her positive perspective.
She was deeply, but very quietly religious, and this faith sustained her all her life. Her parents never stopped trying to find a cure for her, but shortly after her confirmation, she resolved to stop all these attempts.
God has decided this for me, and He will help me bear it, she said. Even so, she never accepted the role assigned to most women of the era, nor the one assigned to her as a handicapped person. Margarete's brother Fritz admired her. He knew she was not like most women of the 1800s. Fritz shared his lessons with her, widening her horizons beyond sewing and cooking. School was easy and fun for Margarete. I loved to go to school, she said. I would not stop for any reason. Learning to sew was more difficult for her. At the local sewing school, Margarete's lack of ability for fine workmanship worried her sisters, and they told her so. They were so able and skillful, while I always made mistakes. I was never so good to do as I was told, like my sisters. They often said, "That bad Greta." Due to her lame right arm, Margarete experienced great pain after only a few minutes of stitching. But she tolerated the pain because she loved inventing stories, starting debates, making people laugh, and singing along with the girls in the class. Despite the physical discomfort in her right arm, she had a long-held dream to learn to play the zither. And soon she was so accomplished musically that she was able to give lessons and make a little money. The money she earned allowed her to purchase a sewing machine, the first in Gingen. She had worked hard to master sewing by hand, so she was discouraged when the sewing machine presented yet another problem.
The wheel that gave the machine its impetus was on the right, and her weak right hand simply could not turn it. This seemed insoluble. She would never be able to speed up to her production to compete with the machine, and she was made deeply conscious of her limitations. But then she had a great idea. She would turn the machine around and sew everything backwards. She herself admits it was a great achievement, and she relished it in all modesty.
Margarete attended classes in Augsburg, a two-day journey away. She learned to set pearls on ladies' blouses, make wool wrist warmers, and sew watch pockets. She became so proficient that she was hired to help with the trousseau of Tisnelda Gross, the pastor's daughter. This project led to sewing for others in the village. Soon she was making clothes for both children and adults. Adolf Glatz, a local businessman and friend, suggested that Margarete open a felt shop. She developed and presented a remarkable business plan to Theodor Dehlinger, the director of the felt factory, and asked for his input. He and others were extremely impressed. "I began making felt underskirts, which had just come into fashion, for the firm of Christian Siegel in Stuttgart," Margarete said. "I was also able to make and sell a few privately. I was very successful even in the first year, and I was able to employ a few people to work for me." The ever-curious Margarete was always looking for new ideas. In 1880, while paging through a fashion magazine, she noticed a pattern for a toy elephant. Felt was the ideal material for this toy, she said. Every scrap of felt had to be used. There could be no waste. The filling would be of the finest lamb's wool. Now I could make these as gifts for the children of my seamstresses, and I tried out the pattern in various sizes. It was Fritz who first realized the true commercial potential of the elephants. He asked his sister to make several for him to sell at markets in the area. His sales success led to the production of more animals, including a poodle, a donkey, a monkey, and a horse. As demand for the toys increased, Fritz encouraged Margarete to move the factory from her parents' home to a larger space, which he designed and built in 1890. Soon the little company was thriving. For almost 129 years, some member of the Steiff family has worked for the company. It's remarkable to think that as a child, her only toys were two small bowls and a cup of lentils. Now she was literally making thousands of toys every week. The little girl who was once physically dependent upon everyone was now providing jobs and livelihoods for as many people in Gingen as she could.
Margarete had enormous influence on her family, especially on her brother's 9 children. She had known them all since babyhood and loved them deeply. She studied their various abilities and directed their education in detail. There were 6 boys and 3 girls, and she insisted that all 9, including the girls, learn both French and English. And she followed their progress in detail.
After completing their education, 6 nephews joined the company. Each man had the degree necessary to work at Steiff in his designated role. Richard as director and lead designer, Otto in advertising, Hugo in engineering, Franz in accounting, Paul in fabrics, and Ernst as building supervisor. Each nephew had been carefully groomed for these jobs. Margarete had also encouraged them to learn the languages of the world. Eventually, it was Richard who invented the teddy bear, the firm's signature item. Through the years, the company would sell millions and millions of teddies for children in all corners of the world. Margarete always insisted upon perfection. From the beginning, she wanted every seam faultless so that the piece would last 100 years. Her motto became, "Only the best is good enough for children." From a very young age, she loved babies and children. So she always pictured her toys in their arms. Her creations mirrored her joyful spirit and fun-loving nature. Her kind-heartedness was not limited just to the very young. She was sincerely interested in the welfare of her seamstresses and wanted Steiff to be a wonderful place to work. Indeed, she instituted flexible schedules and the opportunity for local mothers to sew the toys at home. A handicapped, accessible environment was created so she could go anywhere she wanted in the factory. The ramps were built primarily for her, but she hired the handicapped at a time when doing so was unheard of. She trusted her judgment that they would respond to the unusual opportunity. She was not disappointed. Margarete was always ahead of her time. She became the CEO of a company in an era when women were expected to stay home. She fought to maintain the Steiff trademark and copyright with the force and certainty of a man. She successfully created an industry in an economically challenged area of Germany. She gave hope and inspiration to the handicapped. She positioned Steiff in the international marketplace, and she demanded a standard that still guides the company today. Once a longtime employee of the company was asked what it had been like to work with Margarete. "Ah," he said, "it was fun." Margarete Steiff's legacy lives on, 100 years after her death. Hers is truly a life worth celebrating.